हेलो फ्रेंड्स, नमस्कार. आई एम विनोद कुमार गर्ग, वर्किंग एज अ प्रोफेसर इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एनवायरमेंटल साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी, सेंट्रल यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ पंजाब, भटिंडा. वेन एवर एनी एकेडमिशियन, एनी एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर और एनी साइंटिस्ट आस्क मी ए क्वेश्चन दैट व्हाट आर योर प्रोडक्ट्स एज ए साइंटिस्ट, एज ए टीचर और एज ए इंस्टीट्यूशन, आई यूजुअली से दैट एज ए इंस्टीट्यूशन, एज ए टीचर or as a scientist, we have four products. The very first product is human resource development that we produced in the form of our students. Our second product is research publications, and these research publications are outcome of the research work that we do in our laboratories. Third product is outreach. Outreach means whatever knowledge is generated in our classrooms or in our laboratories that is used for the welfare of the general public, means shifting of knowledge from lab to the land for the upliftment of the society. And our fourth product is the industrial consultancy, means providing the knowledge to the industries so that they can improve their processes, they can improve their products. So with this background, today we are going to discuss in detail about research publications and research quality indicators. Basically, this lecture is having two parts. In the first part, we will be mainly emphasizing on what is research and why to publish this research. And the third question that we will be discussing in this lecture is on the environmental ethics. Nowadays, wherever you go, people talk about plagiarism, and that is directly linked with the research ethics. So we will be discussing about plagiarism, and in the second part of this lecture, we will be discussing that how this plagiarism can be checked, what kind of softwares are available for this plagiarism check. And second point, we will be discussing impact factor. That is a very important component nowadays to decide where to publish and where not to publish. And another research quality indicator is H index, that we will be discussing in the second part. So let us start with a very basic question, that what is research? The systematic investigation into and study of materials and sources in order to establish facts and reach new conclusions is called as research. Whenever you do research or whenever you claim that I am a researcher, then normally a very common question is put from the students or even from the general public, that what is your research good for, where it can be applied. To answer this question, it is best to establish or to know or to tell the difference between basic research and applied research. So let we discuss what is basic research and what is applied research. Basic research is curiosity driven. Basic research is normally motivated by a desire to expand knowledge and involves the acquisition of knowledge for knowledge sake. Let me give you one example. Suppose somebody is interested to know that water will boil at what temperature. So this is the curiosity which a person want to know. Directly it may not be having some benefits, monetary benefits, but at later stage this knowledge can be applied in a number of processes. So basic research is intended to answer why, what, or how questions and increase understanding of fundamental principles of science. Basic research doesn't have immediate commercial objectives, and although it certainly could, it may not necessarily result in an invention or a solution to a practical problem. Let we come to the applied research. Applied research is designed to answer specific questions aimed at solving practical problems. New knowledge acquired from applied research has specific commercial objectives in the form of products, procedures, or services. Let me give you one or two examples. Let me take the example of osmosis. You all know that the phenomena of osmosis was discovered by Wantoff, and he was awarded the first Nobel Prize of the chemistry in 1901. But he didn't get any monetary benefit out of it. But later on, based upon osmosis, the reverse osmosis phenomena was, or the process was developed, and nowadays reverse osmosis, you all know, commonly that is called as RO, is used in a number of processes. ROs are available in almost every house. So the person who converted that basic knowledge of osmosis into product earned a lot of benefit out of that. Let me give you another example of DDT. You all know DDT is a pesticide. DDT was synthesized by a graduate student of the chemistry as a part of his doctoral work. But this was another scientist, Paul Miller, who discovered insecticidal properties of the DDT, and he was awarded Nobel Prize for identifying the insecticidal properties of the DDT. So the person who synthesized, nobody is knowing about them, but the person who explored its potential to be used as insecticide was awarded Nobel Prize, and the company and the scientists earned lot of money out of that. So this is the basic difference between basic research and applied research. Basic research may not be of immediate use, may not be immediately converted into product, but applied research is mainly concerned with the development of some procedure, some product, and here we can have some monetary benefits. Let me have a look on this figure. There are basically two figures. The first figure is a tree, and this tree is indicating that the root of this tree or the trunk of this tree is like basic science, and whereas the fruits which are growing on this tree, they are the applied science. In the another figure, you see that suppose we discuss about heart surgery. For the heart surgery, it is not like this, that heart surgery was developed in a day. Rather, before reaching to the heart surgery, a number of other processes, basic science processes, basic science knowledge was developed, and that knowledge was in the form of electricity, because as long as there is no electricity, we cannot do heart surgery. Then knowledge of biochemistry, then knowledge of gas exchange, ECG, blood types, then heart-lung machine, anesthesia, etc. So when this all knowledge was generated, only then we were able to reach to the heart surgery. So this shows that the base of applied research is basic science. Second most important question is why to publish. Publishing a research paper in a journal or presenting a research paper in a conference, these are important activities within the academic community, because these activities allow scientists or to you to network with other scholars, with the peers, and to further refine your ideas and research. Academic journals are probably the most common place for scholars or researchers to publish their research. Nowadays, huge numbers of publications are available, and many of them may be predatory journals. So, what should be our consideration? How do we decide that in which research journal we publish our research and in which we avoid publishing our research? So the major factors or the important considerations before manuscript submission are editorial time. That editorial time means how much time is taken by the editor for the publication of a particular research article, research paper, or a particular research. You will find some of the journals take decision within a month, and some of the journals may take even a year or more than a year. So in that situation, you should select such a journal that takes lesser time for its publication, but without compromising the other parameters. The another important factor is acceptance rate of that particular journal. Any journal that is having high impact factor, this impact factor we will be discussing in the second part of this presentation, they have lesser acceptance rate. So, and the journals which are predatory journals, or there are a number of journals, they charge publication fee also, their acceptance rate is also quite high. So keep this also into your mind. The third factor is publication fee. Nowadays, a number of journals are available as open access journal. These open access journal charge a fee. For some of the journal, this publication fee is in thousands of dollars. And I think in India, we don't have that much funds that we can pay such a high publication fee. So keep this publication fee also into your mind. Rather, this is my personal experience in a number of interviews, etc. I have found that the experts usually don't consider those publications for which publication fee have been paid, because there is a general assumption in the mind of people that you pay money means publication fee, and any rubbish article, even that is not having any quality, that can be published. The another factor is impact factor of the journals. Nowadays, this is a criteria that is used to decide about the quality of your research, that we will be discussing later on. The another factor that you should keep in your mind, the number of issues published by a journal. Certainly, the journal that will be publishing lesser number of issues will be taking more time in publishing your article, and the journal that is publishing more issues will be taking lesser time. Let me give you example of a journal. There are two, three journals. One of them is Bioresource Technology, and another is Journal of Hazardous Material. These Bioresource Technology, I think, publishing about 25 or 26 issues in a year, whereas this Journal of Hazardous Material is publishing more than 52 issues in a year. So you look for such kind of journals where the number of issues is more. It is generally complained by students or by the scientists that their papers are normally rejected by the journals. So in that situation, we must know that what are the common reasons that these academic research papers are rejected. The research papers are rejected mainly at two levels. First is the rejection of the academic article or research paper by the editor himself, or second rejection may be by the reviewers during the review process. Let me know that what are the common reasons because of that the research papers are rejected by the journal editors. So the most common reasons because of them the research papers are rejected by the journal editors even before sending it for review are: the paper is not relevant to that journal's reader. Means you have sent your research paper to a particular journal, say to journal X, but this article doesn't fit in the scope of the journal. Certainly in that situation, editor is going to reject your article. The second reason may be that the research paper doesn't make a contribution to new knowledge in that particular discipline or the application of knowledge. Means that whatever you have done, that has already been reported by a number of people and there is no novelty in your article. Because of this reason also, your article may be rejected by the editor. Third reason may be that the research paper doesn't meet the established ethical standards. For example, if you have used any animal in your research, that time the clearance from the animal ethics committee should be taken. There should not be any fabrication of data, there should not be any falsification of data, and other ethical standards related to plagiarism should also be followed in your publication. The another reason may be that your paper is poorly written. This is a very common comment that we Asians get from different journals. And the reason of that may be that our mother tongue is not English. The another reason because of which the research papers may be rejected by the journal editor is that the paper has not been prepared according to the journal's guideline for the presentation. So, from these points, we can conclude that whenever you are preparing a research article, you have to keep certain points in your mind. The first point is that you, first of all, you look the guidelines of that journal and prepare or format the article according to the guidelines. Referencing should be done as per the guidelines. Another reason is you should avoid falsification, fabrication as well as plagiarism that we will be discussing in detail just in next few minutes. Then you should submit your research paper to that journal in which this fit most, as well as you should submit that research paper that is having some novelty and the paper is timely. So in that situation, there are very good chances that your article will be passed by the editor to the reviewers for review process. Otherwise, if you don't follow these points, there are very good chances that your article will be rejected even at the editor level. These reasons may also be given by journal reviewers as reasons for rejecting a paper once it has gone through the review process. The reasons for a paper being rejected once it has been reviewed fall mainly into two categories. First category is problem with the research, and second category is problem with the writing or presentation of the research paper. So let me discuss these both one by one. Problem with research. A research paper may be rejected because of problems with the research on which it is based. And these problems may include: the paper describes a poorly conducted study, the research conducted is inadequate to be a research paper, the literature review is inadequate, the paper has problems with the methodologies that have been used in that research, the sample that you have taken for your research is problematic, means the sample is too small, or sample is biased, or sample is self-selected, etc., etc. The another reason may be that the statistics is inadequate, means no proper statistical analysis of the data has been done. Another reason may be that the data has been interpreted poorly, the analysis of the data is weak, or the paper duplicates other work and doesn't report anything new, means similar kind of research paper are already existing and this research paper is not adding any new knowledge. Let me come to the problems with writing and presentation. A research paper may be rejected because of problems with its presentation, and these problems include: the very common reason is that the paper is poorly written, the the author guidelines have not been followed by the authors. The paper is too technical and contain too much jargon. The paper is over the journal's word limit. In most of the journal, good quality journals nowadays put the page numbers limit, words limit, that how many tables should be there, how many figures should be there. This kind of limits are there from a number of journals, so those should be followed carefully, otherwise article may be rejected outrightly without going into the quality of your research. The paper has been carelessly prepared, maybe the another reason. For example, it has inconsistencies or spelling or grammatical errors. If an author has been careless in writing or presenting a paper, the journal editor may suspect or may presume that the author has also been careless in conducting the research on which this paper is based. So these are some of the reasons because of which the papers are rejected. So friends, I will request you, please follow the proper guidelines, prepare article nicely so that there are good chances of accepting the article. Here in this slide, I have shown the trends in scientific publication in some selected countries. If you see this figure, you will find that US has always been at the top with respect to the publications of the research papers. Since 2000 till 2010, this is a data of 10 years, this is showing that USA is constantly producing 140,000 research papers every year. Whereas if you come to the 2000 and you compare two countries, China and India, you will find that each of them was publishing approximately 30,000 research papers in 2000. Whereas in 2000, the number of research papers published by India in the impact factor journals is about 40,000. Whereas the number of research papers published by China are going to touch the number of publications that are coming from USA. So, in this publication journey, where we have done wrong, that China has gone so ahead than us in a span of 10 years, this is a question before us. We should ponder over it and we should think that how we can improve the number of publications in the good quality journals that are recognized at global level. This figure shows the distribution of R&D institutions in India. You will find in this pie diagram that about 50% of the R&D institutions are in private sectors and about 14% are in the central government sector, 20% are in state sector, and only 12% R&D institutions in India are in universities. Again, we have to think, we have to ponder that how this percentage can be increased. Because if this percentage will increase, certainly the number of publications will increase from the universities. When we talk about research, then research ethics are very, very important. We should follow all the ethics for the research, because if any wrong thing we have done and that is detected at a later stage, that may be problematic. That may be a scar on your name, that may be bad for your career. Nowadays, people talk a lot about plagiarism. Let me first try to know what is plagiarism. Plagiarism is directly linked with the research ethics or academic ethics. So, plagiarism is the act of stealing someone else's work and attempting to pass it off as your own. This can apply to anything from term papers to photographs to songs and even to ideas. You might have seen a number of songs in which the tune has been copied from somewhere else. That also comes under the category of plagiarism if proper permission has not been taken. There are several types of plagiarism. Let me discuss them one by one. The very first type of plagiarism is simple copying. Copying is the most well-known and the most common type of plagiarism. If a person copies someone else's work and put his name on it without acknowledgement, it means he has plagiarized. The second type of plagiarism is patchwork. This type of plagiarism occurs when the plagiarizer borrows the phrases and clauses from the original source and weaves them into his own writing without putting the phrases in quotation marks or citing the author. This will also come under the category of plagiarism. Third category of plagiarism is paraphrasing plagiarism. Paraphrasing plagiarism occurs when the plagiarizer paraphrases or summarizes another's work without citing the source. Even changing the words a little or using synonyms but retaining the author's essential thoughts, sentence structure or style without citing the source is also considered as plagiarism. The fourth category of plagiarism is unintentional plagiarism. Unintentional plagiarism occurs when the writer incorrectly quotes or incorrectly cites a source they are using. Dear friends, I will suggest only one thing to avoid plagiarism. Avoid plagiarism to avoid complications at a later stage. Now the question arises that how plagiarism can be avoided. By doing small, simple things, plagiarism can be avoided. Like, whenever you use a source in your research paper, in your assignment, give credit where it is due. Acknowledge the author of the original work you have used. Use your own work as often as possible. Quote or cite your sources properly. Question arises, how to check plagiarism? To check plagiarism, a number of softwares are available. We will be discussing these softwares or plagiarism checkers in the second part of this lecture. Government of India, MHRD, is very serious with respect to plagiarism. In India, the regulations with respect to plagiarism have been published by University Grants Commission. Now we will discuss these guidelines in brief. These guidelines were given by University Grant Commission, New Delhi, on 23rd July 2018 and notified in the Gazette of India on 31st July 2018. These guidelines are very detailed, and the complete document is available on the website of the University Grant Commissions. Dear friends, I will request you, please download that document and read it very carefully, that what is given in this document to avoid plagiarism. I will be discussing only few things. In point 8, in these guidelines, the levels of plagiarism are given. According to that, plagiarism would be quantified into four levels as ascending order of severity for the purpose of its definition. These four levels are level 0. Level 0 means the similarity is up to 10%. This is called as minor similarity, and there is no penalty if the similarity with other sources is up to 10%. Then level 1, it means similarity of your research paper with others is in the range of 10 to 40%. Level 2 plagiarism means the similarity of your research paper, research article or assignment, whatever it is, maybe thesis also, above 40% to 60%. And level 3, that is the highest level, means the similarity of your research paper, thesis, article, etc. is more than 60%. So the penalties in case of plagiarism in submission of thesis and dissertation, institution's academic integrated panel shall impose penalty considering the severity of the plagiarism. If this is of zero level, means similarity is up to 10%, this is minor similarity and there is no penalty for this. If there is level 1 similarity, means the similarity is in the range of 10 to 40%, such students shall be asked by the institute to submit the revised script within a stipulated time period, not exceeding 6 months. Means student can revise and can submit it within 6 months. If level 2 similarity is detected, means the similarity of your document is in the range of 40 to 60%, in that situation, the student shall be debarred from submitting a revised script for a period of 1 year. Means student can submit his thesis or dissertation after 1 year. If level 3 similarity is detected, means the similarity is more than 60%, in that situation, the registration of the student shall be cancelled from the program in which he or she is enrolled. There are two footnotes also given to it. Note 1 is with respect to penalty on repeated plagiarism. Such student shall be punished for the plagiarism of one level higher than the previous level committed by him or her. In case where plagiarism of highest level is committed, then the punishment for the same shall be operative. And the second note is with respect to penalty in case where the degree or credit has already been obtained. Means where the degree has already been awarded, in that situation what should be done? In that situation, if plagiarism is proved on a date later than the date of award of degree or credit, as the case may be, then his or her degree or credit shall be put in abeyance for a period recommended by the institute committee and approved by the head of the institute. These regulations also include penalties in case of plagiarism in academic and research publications. Here also, 4 levels are given. The first level is level 0, means the similarity is up to 10%, again minor similarity and no penalty. And if the similarity is in the range of 10 to 40%, this will be considered as level 1 plagiarism and the author will be asked to withdraw the manuscript. If the similarity is in the range of 40 to 60%, that will come under the category of level 2, and here 3-4 penalties are given. First one is author shall be asked to withdraw the manuscript. Author shall be denied a right to 1 annual increment. Then author shall not be allowed to be the supervisor to any new master's, MPhil or PhD student or PhD scholar for a period of 2 years. If the similarity is above 60%, that is level 3 similarity, here also there are several penalties. The first one is author shall be asked to withdraw manuscript. Second, shall be denied a right to 2 successive annual increments. And author shall not be allowed to be a supervisor to any new master's, MPhil, PhD student or scholar for a period of 3 years. So, dear friends, in this lecture, we have discussed that what is research, what are different types of research, that basic research and applied research. Then with examples, I have explained that applied research can give you immediate monetary benefits, but basic research will not give you immediate monetary benefits. But applied research is the fruit of basic research. Then we discussed that why to publish. Then we also discussed that why our research papers are rejected by editors as well as reviewers, and how we can avoid this rejection. And based upon this all discussion, finally we can say that the data should be timely, properly presented, written in good English, and followed author guidelines, then there are very good chances of the publication of article. The another issue that we discussed was related with the ethics, that was plagiarism. We discussed what is plagiarism, what are different types of plagiarisms, and we also discussed that how this plagiarism can be avoided. Finally, we discussed the guidelines given by university grant commissions with respect to the plagiarisms. We discussed that how the levels of plagiarism will be decided, and we also discussed what penalties can be imposed on the students and faculty members if they found to be involved in any plagiarism. So, dear friends, I will finish this lecture with one line only, that avoid plagiarism to avoid complications at later stage. Thank you.